Yeah, I think we're gonna set up on across the street or across the side. No.
Well, I was introduced to this group in Xochitl In Cuicatl by friends of members that were already, you know, in the group. I was introduced to Juan Francisco Esteva, which is our organizer here at UC Berkeley. And since it's a student-based group, but it's also open to the community, it just seemed like a really, really cool spot to start danzando, and something I've been wanting to do for over 10 years.
Within In Xochitl In Cuicatl, one thing that Juan Esteva has brought up since I first started dancing with the group is that there's always an invisible door where people could come in and come out whenever they want, right? The only thing that we ask is that you come in with respect. And one thing that I add to that is to come in with respect and humility, right?
Because one of the things that we do is we always open up with the four directions, right? And the four directions are very symbolic of many things. They're applicable, I would say, almost to every space, you know? So the four directions, if we think about them as people, we're honoring the people that come from the four directions. We can say the north, the south, you know, the west and the east, you know? So it's like all of us, basically the earth, you know, people.
Students needed here was that they needed to be connected to their roots, and that even though they were trying to get connected to their roots, that they thought that it was necessary to start Aztec dancing, and so they came together and we had our first practice. We talked about danza, we talked about the philosophy of danza, what does it mean, indigeneity, the movement.
Mm-hmm.
believe danza is something that a lot of people can relate to. You know, we're all indigenous, you know, what we were at some point, you know, and we carry that in our blood, and that's something that will always be a part of us. I see it more like an outlet, more than just practice, you know. Other than the physical agility that it develops over time, you know, in your body, your muscle strength, it's more than that. It's very spiritual, you know. Danzar has, you know, released a lot of stress for me in life in general. You take what you want out of danza, and it grounds you, definitely.
Danza is not just about dancing. Danza is about philosophy. Danza is about mathematics. Danza is about astronomy, right? And if you want to call it astrology too, the relationship or the interpretation of how the cosmic bodies affect human beings and affect the living organisms on Earth, whatever. But that ancient knowledge is very important for all of us to learn. And I think there's an awakening right now, because for many years we have been detached from that philosophy. Right now, even the United States is in a cultural and economic crisis, that we are in a self-destructing path, and people don't know how to get out of it. You know what I think it is? The solution to it is native or indigenous spirituality, because it's teaching you how to live in harmony with other individuals, with other people, with other with your surroundings.
Well, the Aztec calendar is not just the Aztec calendar. It was also Mayan, right? It was Mayan first. Maybe it was even Toltec first or whatever. But definitely Mayan had the accurate one. The Mexicas just sort of replicated that.
Danza is actually organizing mesas, and these are traditions that are coming from way back before the pre-colonial times, and these mesas are around family members. So family members teach one another the dances from one generation to the next, to the next, to the next.
What the flower means is, it means many things, but it technically means kind of like, like, you know, the song in Portuguese, that's the name of our group, in Xochitl In Cuicatl, which is song. But it's also to say life and death at the same time. Because before you get the seed, you get the flower, and the flower, in order to get the seed, the flower's gotta die, right? So it's kind of like the ultimate expression of a plant, right? It gives its bloom, its flower, but then that plant also needs to die. But the idea is that it dies to so that it can live again or can produce.
Then the social component of it is when people come together, right? You're not doing a physical activity by yourself, and you're in a group, and you're in sync. It just feels better to do things when you're with a bunch of people. And the more people, the merrier. It's true, right? And people just tend to forget about, oh, somebody's looking at me, or, you know, you become free. And you just go for it. And so that in itself sets the stage to what we call the spirituality. And spirituality means that connection that you have with the person who's right next to you, right? Or the person who's in front of you, and people who are surrounding you. And that feeling, it's amazing.
I think it's really good to see, for example, how Juan, you know, and the reason I bring him up into it is because he's always been really supportive of danza being involved in, and you could say activism, right? Or in some form of activism. The danza comes in, you know, and it opens up the space. And I think it just doesn't open up the space just for the sake of performance. I'm not sure if you already got that, but if you don't have it, it does have the performance aspect of it, of course, but I think the purpose behind it is beyond just, you know, performance, but I think it has to do with like both celebration while at the same time, you know, sort of making it a ceremony, you know, making us all connected with one another, with each other. And I think going back to the Alex Nieto, we have black and brown folks who are experiencing the same thing. So it's, you know, let's create the space, you know, that can bring us together, you know. It's moving in both ways, right? On the one hand, it's sad because here's a life that was snuffed out by the state, by the police officers. And then on the other hand, you have the coming together, right? The coming together of peoples from the four directions, if you will. I was really glad and fortunate to be part of it because, I mean, again, that it goes with our convictions, it goes with what we want to do, and being part of things is, on the one hand, trying to bring not only harmony, but even some form of healing for the family, for example.
a comet in the sky. Va a haber un cometa en nuestros cielos hoy.
Dos.
Y nomás quería decir que este tiempo para nosotros significa Xipetotec, Xochitl. Es el año, es el momento de la primavera, de nuevos principios, de nuestras nuevas luchas. Y esto no se ha parado, estamos siguiendo la lucha, vamos a seguir con justicia. I wanted to say that in our tradition, it is springtime, it is a time of change, it's Xipetotec. Es cuando la culebra se quita, el Quetzalcóatl se quita su piel. It's a renewal, it's when the snake sheds its skin. So we're continuing for justice. This is a new beginning for returning the page on the book of Alex Nieto Justice. And that's what we're doing. Es un nuevo principio para continuar la justicia que nos dejó el trabajo Alex Nieto para toda la comunidad. Eres Dios.
About demonstrating also that, you know, that we care about the community, we want the community to heal, and we want the community to improve.
It's very important for us to be in community during these moments where it's very easy to feel isolated in our own pain. And so I'm glad that we all here are a representation of a larger movement that is here in solidarity with the nietos, right? Yes.
Primeramente, les quiero dar las gracias a ustedes por el honor para darnos su bendición a la comunidad para estar a su lado tras los últimos dos años. Sabemos que nunca podemos reemplazar a su hijo, y ya que no tiene a Alex, ojalá que usted, mientras vea a toda la gente aquí que está reunida, los cientos y miles de personas que han venido tras los últimos dos años, son una reflexión del corazón de su hijo. Y ojalá que usted siempre sepa, ustedes los dos sepan que no están solos.
Right? They're not alone, right?
That's right.
I just want to give a lot of love to all the members of the community who over the past 2 years have consistently and strongly sent a really strong message nationally about this epidemic, right? And that shows a really strong symbol of solidarity from San Francisco to New York to Ferguson, all across the country in our struggle for justice. Yeah. And we should all be very proud. Be very proud that we're part of this movement, because we're on the side of truth, right? On the side of love. And we knew in the last 2 years that it was going to take a lot of work. It took marches, it took teach-ins, it took walkouts, it took petitions, it took events, it took campaigning, it took being out visible, being like putting out the demands visibly, right? For us to get to this point. And we're very clear that the police system is part of a larger power structure that prioritizes profit over people, and that enforces a division between the rich and the poor. And because we know and understand that the fight for justice for Alex is part of a larger movement for land, right? Defending our land and defending our lives and our liberation.
You have whites, you have blacks, you have, you know, brown, native folks, all these folks coming together for this cause and trying to make the place of the world a better place, you know. And unfortunately, it comes down of the killing of a human, of Alex Nieto. But I guess trying to find a positive side of it is also the good thing. I think, you know, this is where we also play a role in that. The intention is what's important, because I think one of the purposes is to let youth know that not only youth, just black and brown and all people in general, but especially the youth, that someone does care about them, you know, that we do care about them, you know. Because one of the things that was important about the Alex Nieto case is that, in a sense, that sends out a message, right, that brown people, but also black people, you know, don't matter.
You guys have heard me speak many times, so, oh, let's bring up Antonio Theodore, please.
Oh, yeah.
This was the witness who saw the actual killing. Antonio, could you come up with me?
Come on,
please, please. Come on. This man stood and heard and saw this. Antonio, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Sorry, you had to go.
Wish that you could stick around some more. Sorry, I wish you could stay. Maybe we'd have met in the park one day. Yeah, yeah. Sorry, you had to go. I wish that you could stick around some more. Sorry, I wish you could stay. Oh, Alex, boy, you're my friend till today. We gonna stand, keep on standing strong. We gonna stand, and know that you will always, always live on. Sorry, you had to go. I wish that you could stick around some more, yeah. Sorry, wish you could stay. And I met you up in that park, yes, one day. Whoa.
Give it up for this man right here. He is a hero for somebody to come forward and actually do what he did. This is a hero. Whenever you see the word hero in the book, this is a hero right here. Please hug this man, give this man love. He is a brother, he is our familia. This is how we do it in La Mission. We take care of each other, and this man is connected forever with Alex Nieto.
So beautiful.
I began dancing within Xochitl In Cuicatl in around June 2011 as I was wrapping up my college time. It became a really important part of my life during that time because I was going through a lot of transitions, and I think at that time I was also looking for something more deep to connect to that didn't revolve around student organizations or organizing on campus, and more meaningful to the time of my life that where I was like learning more about my identity and connecting and tapping into more tradition, but also more like spiritual and personal healing at the time.
To me, it's a mixture of physiological and social fulfillment that exercising creates the happy hormones, right? So it triggers your brain and it makes you happy. It does, right? Any type of exercise that you do. There are, for instance, stories of dancers that they get into the zone, that's what they call it, the zone. And they just don't know, they just feel that they're like flying when they're running, right? Well, it's like it's an ecstasy that comes in when you get into that mode and you're dancing really hard, that it doesn't really feel like dancing anymore. It just feels like you're in this zone.
Alcatraz, class of 1969, 1970, more 1970.
It was actually Alcatraz was a defining moment in the Indian rights movement. It was the beginning of the Indian movement across this country. And one good shining example of that is the Declaration of Human Rights for Indigenous People. And all the work that went into this movement. And you're here to celebrate and honor that struggle. So with that, I'd like to say a short prayer in my Diné language. Alcatraz Island, 1969-1970. Richard Oakes, John Trudell, Russell Means, Otto D. Cornhinnai, Leonard Peltier, Jado, Dathnitz, and Edigut Art Citizen, Iliad, Bailiadole, Kelashatra, the Inha, Shada Ana, now comes Behajon a slave, Behajon a slave, Behajon a slave, Behajon a slave, ho!
These are actually like for like people who do like yoga, Pilates, all that kind of. I got them at Ross for like 10 bucks. They're nice.
The Danza Mexica Azteca that we do, I believe that it sort of ruptures, you know, the colonial imaginary. You know what I mean? About, you know, I identify as Mexica, as indigenous. So people like myself that we have, the yearnings that we have to try to reconnect ourselves with not only our people, but also even with, you know, the legacies of our ancestors, you know, the things that they left behind, the knowledge that they have passed down to us, as fragmented as it may be.
Native American people, indigenous people in this continent, have been taken away, their land has been taken away, their culture, right, their languages, or that we people know about indigenous, is from book, indigenous people, from books. And books were written by whom? Not by indigenous people. They were written by the colonists.
This I've been able to like really like own and reclaim and take back the fact that we come from colonization, and because of that, a lot of the times we're simply relearning what was there before. But even more than that, as we're dancing and as we're organizing and as we're engaging with one another, I've began to remember a lot of these things that were maybe in my family back in the day, but for some reason we're not talked about, we're not brought up, or were forgotten because we moved away from that, right? And growing up, again, I didn't have that direct connection with the tradición, the danza, but it wasn't obscure to me either. It's not something that I ignored or negated, but rather I didn't know it yet.
And, you know, you get caught up in the sacredness of it. And I would say, for the record, it is sacred, but it's not sacred in the sort of holy sense, you know? I got to learn what sacredness means of it, you know, in our own interpretation. And it's sacred because it's the only thing we have. You know, it's some of the few things that we were able to keep, you know? And these are the only things that we're able to lean from to go back and to learn. That's why they're sacred.
I think when we dance, we offer a prayer, but we also offer resistance, because we live in a reality where indigenous people are not recognized day to day. This used to be Mexico, this used to be Tenochtitlan, Aztlan, and so we have to pay that respect to like where we stand in right now. Different celebrations and ceremonies that we have, we do it as one people, bringing different traditions and different danzas into play. So we're not trying to differentiate yourselves from one another, simply work together and pray together and offer together for the mere survival and resistance that we deserve.
Like our responsibility as, you know, I would say as Mexica peoples, but also just, you know, having a common experience with other native folks, this is like a responsibility to think about and to talk about what has been done to our people, you know. But I feel that it's a way to bring all this back up, kind of like going back to that guy from Europe, right? He's like, oh, I thought you guys were extinct. Basically, that's what he was saying, right?
Because it's a mirage. Like, you don't see it, it's not there, or I don't talk about it, it's not there.
Right. It's like, no, we're not extinct. But, you know, we're not that close from actually making peoples be extinct, you know what I mean? So politically, that's one of the roles that I feel personally we need to get at. Not just to say, oh, white supremacy is bad, and this, it's like, no, you know, you could potentially be extinct too, you know? It's like you begin with indigenous people and then you just start moving up the ladder. So it's more like a humanity thing, you know? It's being politically aware of what it is to be human. Not so much just indigenous, even though I think the indigenous or First Nation peoples allows us to understand the beginning of how to think about that extinction. And so that's, I think, my role in the movement, in the Mexica movement, or as some of the native folks from over here call us, you know, the Mexica society, you know. That's how I feel my role is. It's not so much just to put Mexica out in the forefront, that's just where I'm from and my people where I'm from, but it's also a part of me that aligns itself with like what humanity should be, you know?
To me, to teach people about their indigenous background, the indigenous culture, it's about a affirmation of love. So what I mean with that is people who don't have an identity, a culture, and a history tend to fall into self-hate because of the contradictions that are built within living in a society that does not like you, that does not value, and working within institutions that negate your own humanity. But if you reject who you are, what's left? Nothing.